The answer is both, right? So we were to look at the entire landscape and existing organizations, looking at best practices and looking at how we can support those, but then also identify where are the gaps that are in the system and looking at how we address those gaps as well. It's a great question. So it's a 10-year initiative. I'm starting this year, running to 2025. Every day at work, I get up with the very clear idea in my head that I'm trying to work myself out of a job. I'd love to hit 80% before 2025, and I'll be honest with you, I actually think we can do it. I mean, I honestly believe that if we can work together as a community, my gut tells me we can get from 40 to 60 just by doing a lot of the alignment stuff that we talk about. 60 to 80 is going to be the really hard pull, because that's going to be trying to solve things that lots of other people have been trying to solve, and it's really, really hard, right? And when I talked about those two groups of kids, like the group that really is interested in reading, they're really struggling, that's a different group of kids to work with. That's part of that 40 to 60. The 60 to 80 is how do we get kids that not engaged, parents that are not engaged, right? How do we help support those kids? You know, in cases where we can't get the parents engaged, but yet we still need to get those kids reading anyways, that's going to be the hard part. And the only way we're going to do that is by working together in a very concerted, deliberate way. But 10 years. I would say we don't have a percentage in mind, but what I would say is I think there's an opportunity for the county and others as well to think about this idea of how do we promote early literacy in all of the things that we're doing. So, for example, you're supporting, they have a great system of recreation centers like the one we're in. We have children and families coming to them. How can we support early literacy in the programs and efforts we're already supporting? In California, they had this idea that they called it health in all policies. And they were looking at all the ways that they were doing things already. How could they promote health within the goals they had? I would ask the question for us, how can we support early literacy in everything that we're already doing? So wherever we're touching children and families, whether it's public housing and the housing authority, whether it's the recreation centers, if you're a business, here's an example that actually came, Katie, early. You're a business and you sell tires, right? This is a real example. Someone who has a tire service center contacted Re-Charlotte early and said, what can we do? Put some books in the lobby, children's books in the lobby of your tire center so that children, while they're waiting with their parents, can read books. There are ways that all of us can help support this effort with things that we're doing already. The one thing I would say, though, is that I want to make sure we don't go too far and that there are lots of other issues besides early literacy that are important that we know are all connected. So my hope is that while we do galvanize and work together to support literacy, it's not at the expense of other things that we also know are important. And I do believe there are ways that we can do both. So for example, we see, for example, there's some programs that provide books in medical facilities. So when you come to the doctor's visit, right, that there are books there, and they're providing that literacy opportunity while children are waiting areas. We can do those kinds of things in the community in ways that we're adding together and not subtracting from initiative support literacy. When I came to interview with the Re-Charlotte board, I told them that the first thing I wanted to do was just get out and talk to people in the community. And that was incredibly important to me. If they didn't support that, I wasn't the right guy for the job.
Yes.
I didn't know any other way to do it. And I think there are two kinds of data. So there's one kind of data that, you know, numbers and statistics and, you know, you put it on spreadsheets. And then there's a really important kind of data that come from stories, that come from our lived experiences. And that's some of the most important kinds of data, right, that we have. And the only way we get that is by talking to families and children and learning, you know, what their lived experiences are. Because otherwise, we're gonna do the wrong thing. Why is it that so many boys don't seem to be able to read proficiently by the end of third grade? It's not because they can't do it. right? It's not ability. There's something else going on, and we need to understand that. And the best way that you do that is by talking with them. Someone earlier asked about parent engagement. How do we develop the right kinds of strategies, right, to engage parents, to help them in this process without talking to parents? And we need to talk to lots of parents, because this is not a one-size-fits-all kind of thing, right? Depending on where you are, your issues may be different. But then again, we also know that there are issues that are common across the entire county. One of the reasons that I came here is because there was a recognition by the group that put this together is that this is an issue that affects all children. You cannot go to a school in Charlotte-Mecklenburg schools and not find a child somewhere that's struggling with reading. And particularly when you talk about boys, that's interesting because I think it cuts across the board. I've talked to all kinds of folks that are parents that struggle with this issue. How do I help my boy, right, get better in reading or get engaged in reading? And I would imagine if we had a meeting tomorrow, we'd have parents of all stripes across the county that would be interested in that conversation. And so this really is an issue that affects all of us. But the only way that we, you know, do the right things is by collecting lots of information so that we go from what we think or what we assume to what we know, so that we are actually developing the right strategies that we're actually going to move the needle on this. This is too important for us to guess, especially when there's so much that we can know by simply asking people questions and looking at research and data. This is not a new issue. And what's shocking to me is as I look into some of the research, some of the research is old, decades old. Ellen McIntyre at UNC Charlotte College of Education knows this. Some of this is not about discovery. Some of it would be local and understanding specific to Charlotte. But some of this research, it's been around for a long time, right? We can be among the first in the nation to actually do something with it and to actually change trajectory of children's lives by improving the number of kids that are reading on grade level.